Alright, time for some more of Alone in the Dark. Alright, so that's where I left off last time. They've been offering at the Whispering Tree. Although I'm still trying to figure out exactly what I'm missing in both. Oh, I gotta go pay Dr. Gray a visit at his place. So I think the more beneficial route would be just to go visit Dr. Gray. I'm not gonna be, where's his apartment at? Let's see here. Gotta figure out somehow how to get to the servants', oh, right, to the stairway. Something. What the? All right, Dr. Gray, time to go find out what's all the hubbub. What's she doing here? Oh, now we transform ourselves into Resident Evil. What do we have here? False book. Myth of the Golden Fleece. It's a hollow book. Yeah, now we become Resident Evil all of a sudden. Or was this the original camera angle for Alone in the Dark? This is kind of weird. First meeting transcript.
Good to finally meet you, Mr. Hart. I'm here on behalf of your brother, Philip. You were expecting me, weren't you?
Yes, your father, yourself.
That's right. I just wanted to ask you a few questions.
Jorge. Wait there, man. Hey, take a look. Is he? Oh, he is the author.
It's a magnificent book, life-changing even. The real Juan is long dead, but I like to think of him as my friend, my most beloved friend. I see. Do you often do this fantasies about people you read about? No? Well, there is Jacob. Who is Jacob? Turn to the last page, Doctor. Oh, it's a newspaper article. The prisoner of ICE, Jacob Van Aste. Is he also your beloved friend? Oh, no, Doctor, not at all. He is the fire that fights fire. Yes, I think it's clear that your overstimulated imagination, this mania, needs to be tempered for you to live a normal life. I know your family calls it the Heartwood Curse, but I want you to know that there is nothing supernatural about your condition. It's all inside your head, and with that, I'm very qualified to deal with. In time, you will be cured. In time. In time. Yes, in time, we will exorcise all your demons, all the dark men. Ah! Please, Mr. Heartwood, calm yourself. Ah! What happened? Oh, don't you worry your little head about it, Miss Hopwood. Your uncle and I just had our first breakthrough. The Snake Dagger. I'll read the rest here. Yale Klein, printed 1921, Lumina. A Ludwig Prinz book on pagan rituals called The Mystery of the Grave, as translated by Nicholas Vacky. There are several references to a sacrificial dagger called the Snake Dagger. It has long been thought of as a poor translation of the original text. It would be more appropriate with Worm Dagger from the Latin Vermis Cultrum. This seems natural following the recent consensus that the original title of Prinz's book, De Vermis Mysterious, would literally translate to The Mystery of the Worm. However, this would take away from Vacky's great effort at translating the underlying meaning of the words and revealing several cultural beliefs. While Prinz certainly was using the term worm as a symbol or a synecdoche for death and the dead, which is made clear by the contents of the book, in the case of the dagger, we shouldn't be too hasty to dismiss its translation. Reading through Vacky's correspondence with his patron, it appears that he had more than just the Latin text at his disposal. Becky had dug up Prince's living relatives and uncovered several cross-referenced historical texts and an actual snake dagger. The dagger was dated to early Middle Kingdom of Egypt and had such a clear shape of a wave that Becky considered calling it the sinusoidal blade. Knowing the full story, it seems prudent that he chose to translate it as snake and not worm. There are several reasons why this choice of word helps us to understand the pagans that Prince's book attempts to describe. The symbolic value of the shape becomes more apparent when reading about the use for the dagger. In the passage of possession and exorcism, we find the snake dagger poisons the poisoner within the victim and is therefore pacified. Where the literal text would tell us that the worm dagger trumps the demon possessing the victim, it tells us nothing of their reasoning, only that somehow this dagger wins against the demon, like it had the better hand in poker. Becky's translation allows us to follow the underlying logic to the ritual magic that is being performed. Poison the poisoner sounds like fighting fire with fire. That to hurt the demon possessing its victim, the priest would have to fight back with a power that is known to the evil they are fighting. The snake dagger is therefore not only a good way to describe its form, but also helps us understand how it could be thought of as a useful tool for exorcism. Finally, it also helps us to understand the relationship to lunacy, that it was thought of as something poisoning the mind rather than controlling it. What is also interesting to note is that the possessed are always considered poison in their head and not their heart. The snake dagger always went through the eye of the possessed, leaving them partially blind if they had the good luck to survive. Very surprised, like I said, at this point in the game, it changed the trans. Oh, furniture key. Hmm. Open the closet, there's nothing inside. Go figure. There's gotta be more to this. I'll have to go back to the other couple of rooms. Investigate the broken clock. Seems like we're missing pieces here. Toy talisman. Possessed, huh? This just feels weird playing Actually, I stand corrected here. This is not Resident Evil S. This is actually how the original game was done. Create a more suspenseful atmosphere. Now it's just a matter of trying to find this clue so I can fix the clock and get out of here. There's gotta be a clue here somewhere. Huh, There's something on the floor. What could that mean? Like I said, there's stuff on the floor here, but I just can't quite grasp it. What could this mean? I'm just trying to figure something out here, like, who's that off here? It's just so vague. It's like, what am I supposed to do? More than 8 hours. Huh. Okay. I guess I'll take it. Like I said, there's gotta be more in here somewhere. I mean, yeah, I'm well aware that there's a talisman on the floor, there's markings on the floor, but what does it mean? Well, like I said, I don't have time to be playing guessing games. We gotta get going on this. I don't have time to be thinking around. Because, yeah, I don't want to be spending all stream doing nothing. I like to get stuff done. I was just there. What? Why do I feel like an idiot right now? The answer was so simple, it was right in front of me. Now we're back to normal. Normal. Plus this game. That's funny. Ice pick. Nice. And now we got a flare gun. Okay, I didn't ask for it to, I didn't ask for you to take a drink, but you know what? That's fine. Just let it go. This once. Next time I might not be so understanding. Down. One thing I'm surprised about is that our good friend the detective isn't complaining about the cold. Jesus. Oh, for Christ's sake. Oh my God. Really? Better. Huh, that's more like it. heck? Oh. There we go. See ya. Got him. Jesus! Oh my god! I mean, I know what to do, but still. You know, instead of stabbing him just once, just stab him a bunch of times, you know? I mean, it just works. Later. Oops.
I did everything! Aren't you happy? Stupid Charlotte. What more do you want from me? You want me to lose my mind?
Yes.
Oh, my love! Doctor! Baptiste!
Chapter 5. Now we're getting to the good parts.
not standing up.
Well, if it isn't the hero of the day. How are you feeling, Detective?
Never better. How about you two? Hey, Jeremy, I didn't do too much damage, did I?
Things are fine. Very quiet.
He'll be fine.
To lobotomize, dear Jeremy.
I did what?
It's actually quite impressive. It's not like I hadn't considered it myself. I just wish Jeremy could have been helped without reducing his personality to that of an oyster.
But he's gonna live.
Of course. As long as someone keeps feeding him, he'll outlive the best of us.
I gotta talk to everyone. I think the word he's trying to look for is symbolic. I talk to everyone.
Everyone knows what to do. Y'all know the new words.
Mrs. Thompson, we talked about this. I'm sure everyone is comfortable.
Doctor, insist. This is war. We've waited for so long now.
Let's just go with the rules. Nothing changes in the rules. It's been it all. But we don't know what we're dealing with.
It'll be okay.
Oh my god. Oh dear Jesus.
Are you crazy?
Wow. I believe we're now getting down to the nitty-gritty of things. I guess we gotta figure out how to get out of here. We'll be all set to go. That is ugly. Like, very, very ugly. Hey, I'm happy I got supplies for the final battle, but, I said you have to go for the eyes. Jeez. Crucifix. Ooh. That's a pretty interesting. Christ, I hit up! Whoop! Okay, I hit up on the D-pad, and it doesn't register. I'm sorry, that's not how it works. And I have to start all the way up here. Where am I exactly? I'm on a roof, but how did I end up up here? Oh, I gotta start this all over again? That's ridiculous. Again. Oh, I see. I get more navigational freedom. Oh, for God's sakes. Really? Oh, my Lord. Jesus Christ alive. Again. Up. Drink out. Flask. I'm sorry, but your logic does not compute. Wow. I'm really getting tired already here. Thank you. Oh, Jesus, again? We're gonna have to go through this? Oh my god! What part of... Oh my god. Wow. I mean, that is so unfair. I hit the button in time and it doesn't register. That makes absolutely no friggin' sense. And I'll be doubly disappointed if I don't kill one enemy with a crucifix. Because I want the power of Christ to compel him. What the? In one hit? Oh my flippin' god. Like I said, the first part of the battle's not that bad. Nothing I can't handle. But... I had, like, 2/3 health? And he killed me in one hit. That's not how it works. Oh my freaking god. And I was nowhere near that big, ugly guy. Oh my god. And I still didn't get my kill with the crucifix. Okay, what is going on? I still want to kill with the crucifix. Come on, just one kill is all I ask for. Ugh, that is just ugly. No, seriously, that is just a whole case of ugly. I bet the flare gun doesn't quite work. Maybe the shotgun does. I want to kill one of these guys with a crucifix. Come on. There. Now I got my wish. At least I'm happy now. After all that, much better. Whew. If I was her, I would be scared to the point where I'd piss my pants. Become one big happy family. At least Jeremy and Emily are still considered family. As far as the mansion goes, I don't know. Well, that takes care of, that takes care of Edward, but we're not quite done yet. There's Emily's side of the story we gotta do. Yeah, because this is a two-parter. We have to do Emily's story now. And plus, I think there's new items and new puzzles to solve for Emily. And I think the ending is different. I mean, I don't know. But like I said, this game's not done, not by a long shot. I'm just doing this to see if there's any post-credit stuff. You can now play with all new with all weapons unlocked, deadlier cabinets, and some new surprises when starting a new game. Well, yeah, because I gotta do what Emily said of the story now. We're gonna be skipping a lot of the story. Chapter 1, Emily. So she's carrying a Makarov.
coughing? What are you doing? I told you not to lose sight of the girl.
Don't you worry, Mags. I'll find that little bastard.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
I'm sorry about all this, but I'm looking for my uncle. His name is Jeremy Hart.
What are you doing, child? You shouldn't be alone. Go find the coffee.
Who are you? Are you here for the Fey Dodo?
Go upstairs now.
My name is Emily Hartwood. I'm the niece of Jeremy Hartwood. This is Detective Carney.
Police? Why are you here?
No, I'm a private investigator. Sorry about it. My client's worried about her uncle. He's a patient here. If you don't mind, could you direct us where to find him?
No, I can't. Jeremy has gone missing. Leave your information, I will make sure to call
him. Wait, he ran away?
No. Leave the house. He's around here somewhere, and both of our orderlies are looking for him.
That's unacceptable. Where's Dr. Gray? I want to speak with him immediately.
Fine. I'll ask him. Wait here and don't touch anything.
Have you ever seen anything like this? Looks like a talisman.
You mean like this one?
Find me enough to cut the canvas. I want to take this one.
You want to take the painting? Sure.
All night. Jeremy? Where did...
Batiste?
How did you get him?
I was back at Dorsetto. Looking for my Uncle Jeremy.
Jeremy's your uncle? I didn't know.
Where would you? You're still working at Dorsetto?
Yeah, both me and Lana stuck around. We're real orderlies now. You remember my sister Lana, don't you?
What happened, Batiste? How are we here?
You know about the dark man, Hart, and your uncle?
I'm familiar with his mental state.
I think we all in his head somehow. But these streets are real. But they're not locked on any map. Nah, it's like when you remember something in the wrong way.
You know how to get back to Dorsetto? I'm not safe.
She was, and yet we spoke to Mrs. Marcus.
Don't call me. It's Miss Emily Hartwood. There's no reason to call me anything else.
I'm sorry, Miss Emily. I'm just trying to tell you how it is. This place ain't safe for no one. There's evil hiding in the dark.
How do I get back?
The jug goes out. He has this juju necklace guy.
You mean this talisman?
Just like it. He says it's been protected ever since he got up from Miss Jackson down the street.
You know where it came from.
I was there no more than 1 hour ago looking for Jeremy. Locked it up to keep the ghost from getting inside. For now, the key.
Mrs. Thompson told me. She also alerted me that you brought it to detective. Very curious to hear what this is all about. You don't remember me, do you, Miss Harper? We met at your family's house in the Garden District when your uncle was about to be admitted under my care.
No, I remember. Sorry. I'm not really feeling well.
In that case, have a seat. Let me make you a drink. I don't seem to have made much of an impression. On the other hand, I can vividly recall.
Because of our cheerful disposition, I'm sure.
You are far too intelligent to think that. You come from a joyless family, Miss Harper. The only amusement I took from my visit was discovering that the young lady's drink was an passion.
Very astute. Is that supposed to make you seem attentive or intelligent?
Whatever you prefer. Are you ready to tell me why you are here, Miss Hardwood? And why you brought a detective?
I received a letter from my uncle. He seemed certain that he was in danger here. If I find out you're treating him badly, I'll be taking him back with me to New Orleans.
Really? Is he going to live with you in your tiny garçonnière? That would be a spectacular way to gratify your spinster. Because you are well aware that your father would never let him back in his house. No, I haven't. Maybe you can move back.
You've been wanting to move back for quite a few years, haven't you? You always preferred your mother's side of the family.
Jeremy is free to leave. I won't object. However, there is one problem, as you might have learned. He is, in fact, missing.
Do you know where he could have gone?
No, I'm afraid I don't. I have my staff with him. I'm sure he will show up eventually.
Especially if he learns that you are here. He is quite fond of you.
What can you tell me about his condition? I never heard a proper diagnosis. What is your medical opinion of him?
Well, he is an anxious man, depressed, even. He suffers from a perceived lack of order in his inner and outer life. He constantly complains about events not presenting themselves according to their divine nature.
In the Dark Man?
Hard to tell if it was ever anything specific. Jeremy uses the Dark Man as a psychological scapegoat to avoid facing the truth that he is in any way at fault.
You don't think there can be any truth to the Dark Man's supernatural existence?
Why would you ask that?
Can we ever be sure?
If the Dark Man is some sort of evil presence that is in possession of Jeremy?
Well,
I assure you, any evidence that you experience supporting that claim is purely delusional. Don't get caught up in mass hysteria, Miss Harper. You wouldn't want to take your uncle's place in this hospital, would you?
I'll be leaving my number. I need to keep looking for my uncle.
Do so, Miss Harper. I'll let you know if he shows up.
Just like that, we're in chapter 2.
Detective Carnby! God, I'm glad to see you. I was afraid you had left.
Me? You're the one who just disappeared.
It's hard to explain. I think I blacked out. It was like I went somewhere else.
It's okay, miss. You're clearly upset.
No, it's... I don't know what's happening.
This is a very stressful situation for me, I understand.
Ugh, no, you don't understand.
Just take a deep breath. Why don't you sit down, smoke some of the perique? If you want, I could even drive you back to New Orleans. I just want to have a talk about the brain first.
I want to stay. I found a talisman just like the one in the painting. I think I might be able to figure out where Tarawea is, where Jeremy wanted to go.
That's great. Just stay out of trouble, okay? Let me handle the investigation.
I'm not crazy, Detective. Not yet.
Catch you later.
I already know all this. We're not going to read this stuff again.
Thank you.
Glass Plantations of Louisiana. Yeah, I don't think... I think this is a new book. I don't think I've read this one. Glass Plantations of Louisiana, Theory of Bricklow, 1917. Dorsetto was a small plantation on the eastern shore of Lake Pontchartrain. The land was considered difficult for industry and was sold for only $30 to Elijah Pickford in 1818. Pickford employed hundreds of workers from nearby New Orleans to clear the woods and build a small plantation mansion facing the lake with a striking Greek Revival temple facade. Dorsetto kept a modest production of perique, tobacco, and indigo that persisted up until the Civil War. During the antebellum era, Dorsetto was the source of many rumors concerning voodoo and witchcraft. People who traveled the lake reported seeing people dance at night in front of bonfires, bleeding and wailing. On June 17, 1862, Captain J.W. Norton of the Union Army recounts leading a raiding party from ships anchored to Lake Pontchartrain in order to seize control of Dorsetto and free the slaves working there. The captain was surprised to find the workers fighting back with unprecedented zeal. Norton's account describes these men and women as enraged with fanaticism. Pickford reportedly tried to placate the raiders, but was shot in the confusion. Captain Norton left the mansion burning and retreated to his ships with his men. Dorsetto was left in ruins for several decades. The ownership of the land was long disputed and returned to the Ledoux family in 1901. Several police reports were filed during the following years as the Ledoux tried to get rid of a camp of squatters on their land. The police made several visits to remove the trespassers, but the people kept returning. On November 1, 1907, Inspector Lagrasse of the police charged a deadly attack in order to save several children kidnapped by the squatters. Many were killed and even more were jailed. The following year, Ledoux rebuilt Dorsetto, incorporating the surviving stone foundation and adding a magnificent wrought iron conservatory. The farmland had been reclaimed by the surrounding woods, so it was no longer profitable to use as a plantation. Instead, the house was turned into an artist colony. Wait, I think this is starting to bring back here. Anyways, the Astarte Artist Colony was a successful group of artists, including figures such as painter Henri Cassel and the poet Nora Keith. The group is also known for their beloved Mardi Gras crew called the Pirates of Pontchartrain. On September 20, 1915, a tropical hurricane tore through Louisiana, causing Pontchartrain to flood New Orleans. Due to the remote location of Dorsetto, it took almost 2 weeks for outsiders to learn that the artist colony was abandoned. The 12 residing artists had all but vanished without a trace. The empty mansion of Dorsetto still stands upon the shore of Lake Pontchartrain with much of its simple facade intact. The Ledoux family has currently had no intention of repairing the house. I think on that note here, I think this is a good place to stop. Oh, I think that's a good place for right now. So like I said, we're not quite finished yet here, but thank you to those who watched. I'll see you all next time.